We're cool, Jace.
Awesome, thank you. It's Dave Lawrence, and we are here at Hawaii Public Radio and in the Atherton, which is our performing space that we have. We do classical music, we do acoustic shows, a lot of different kinds of performances. There are even lectures, there's poetry readings, a variety of things that relate to the community here. And a very special guest joining us, perhaps the most special guest we've had in the room in quite some time, Ziggy Marley. Aloha and mahalo for coming, brother.
Aloha.
I really appreciate you being here. It's a pleasure. And it's sort of a follow-up to an interview that we did a few weeks ago. And it was a fun interview for me.
Yeah.
We talked about a lot of things that it was revealing. You shared some family insight. You shared some insight into our mutual connection of geography, that whoever thought Wilmington, Delaware would be something that we'd have in common. And I wanted to follow up on a few of the things that you mentioned that I thought were special and that I've never heard you speak about in other interviews. One of those you referred to was the struggle in Jamaica. And you talked about Rita staying home, Bob not being there, and it being really a formative thing because after that, you said she really had an impact on your father, that maybe with the whole Rastafarian thing. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to hear you elaborate a little on that period in time and how that ended up influencing your family.
Well, I wasn't born fell out of that that period when they were exposed to the idea of a different concept of, you know, religion or faith, because in Jamaica, you know, with the history of Jamaica through slavery and the colonization and things like that, it was a very closed society in terms of the freedom of thinking. So this was a very radical idea in Jamaican society at the time, where a set of youths came up with this concept of, you know, God not being a white man, God being a black man.
it was an awakening in a lot of ways.
Yeah. To what I understand of it, and what I've heard throughout the years, because I've been around my mother, my father, I've been around the elders, I've been around the teachers, I've been around, you know, what we would call the prophets, you know, the John the Baptist of our society, who taught us a lot of the history of the movement. So my understanding of it is, again, the beginning of the awakening for my parents happened while they were in Trenchtown, which was the ghetto, which was a poor part of Kingston. And that is where this movement started from. And in the beginning, the existing status quo in Jamaica was very frightened, upset, and looked down on the people that were in this movement, you know. My father had left, and my mother had stayed back in Jamaica. While my father was gone, there was a lot of development in the philosophy, in the movement.
It really took off.
Yeah. He wasn't there at the time. So when he came back, it was my mother who kind of brought him up to speed. And at first, he wasn't really into it, you know. But after time, she kind of, you know, explain to him what this was all about. And at the same time, what was happening in America was the civil rights movement and the, you know, I guess some want to call it the black awakening in America.
But a parallel, also, for sure.
Yeah. So, because Jamaica was very influenced by America, you know. The woman, as it is now, it's funny, it came back around again. But in those days, you know, the women them wanted to look like the American women, them, the hairstyles and things like that. What the Rasta movement did was break that kind of hold that that culture had on the women in Jamaica. So when my father came back from America, my mother looked like a whole different person than what he left. Because in the beginning, it was just like, you know, 60s style.
Traditional hairstyle, kind of.
Permed, whatever. Right. When he came back, she was like...
Dread.
What happened to my woman? Like, what happened to my woman, you know? So he was a bit surprised at that change, at that drastic change. You know, where's my woman? What happened to my woman? Come on. But soon, you know, he got more into it and understood what it was all about.
Was that his resistance in just how strikingly different things were when he came back? How was he resistant?
Well, as far as I understand, his first encounter with the change was his woman. He left his woman one way, he came back and saw his woman another way. Like, you know, if just think about it for me or any guy. You know, if you leave your woman, you know, nice looking, whatever, firm, you come back and she's like, what? You're not combing your hair anymore? What? You're not putting on the whatever, you know? It's a big difference for a man, you know? So it's not what he was used to or what I would be used to if I left my woman or whatever. So I think that was a big impact, you know?
And did you, from the time you were young, how did that impact play out on you? At what point did it really kick into your own life?
Well, it kicked in from the beginning, you know, because we always were around the movement from birth. And as we grew older, you know, as children, you know, our father would take us to the, you know, the Nyabingi ceremony. I'll make it so that people can understand ceremony, the Rastafarian ceremonies, which was basically a drum circle with a fire, a big fire in the middle, and singing and chanting and dancing and, you know, praying and...
Very spiritual.
Yeah, that's so spiritual. Very, very, very spiritual. Very spiritual. And so, you know, we were around that too, you know, from we were young. And, but I also was a rebel, you know, because, you know, my father, you know, a father want his son to be like him, you know, but I had a mind of my own from when I was a young child. And I would kind of, sometime maybe upset my father by what I would say to him.
Like what?
Like he would say to me, like I remember one time we were in Trinidad. He did a show in Trinidad. Me and my brother went. And he was like, he said to me something about, you're going to be dread like your father or something. I said to him, yeah, you can't be dread in your heart, right? He got very upset with me for saying that to him, you know? So, you know, I remember that. But otherwise, I think I was more, you know, my mother reminded me, I was a little mama's boy, you know. I will stick with my mother a little bit more. But, yeah, we were always around it. And as I grew, and again, being around it, I grew up with a lot of the elders who, even after my father passed away, I still was learning so much more about the culture and the movement and what it was, you know?
So it was communal in terms of how you were picking it up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was a lot more than your dad.
Yes,
and
yes.
Your mom. Who were some of the other people that people that we have not heard of, perhaps, in the folklore of how you developed into you?
All right. So, well, you know, Planet is a big person in the folklore. He's the one who basically took a lot of the young youths, including my father, my mother, and kind of expose them to certain ideas. Then we had, I can't remember some of them names right now. There was this other old man, because we used to be on the beach. There was a community that we stayed in a lot that was just on a beachfront in a place called Bull Bay. It was my family, Bonnie Whalers, and just Rasta, just a lot of Rasta people just...
And we're in Jamaica, approximately geographically.
It's a little bit outside of Kingston.
Okay, that general area.
Yeah. And it was just a community of people just shacking up and, you know, we just kind of...
Like a hippie commune?
I don't know. I don't know what a hippie commune is, but it was just... you know, those people building their little zinc houses and stuff and whatever. And so we were there a lot, and there's this one old man, you know, oh man, I can't remember his name. Anyway, he's a man who, every time, he used to give me eggs every morning from his chickens. I remember him. Old, but he was like a very majestic, you know, like one of the real elders of the movement. He was older than my father. He was like an old man. So there was him, and there was another one who came around much later. When we were at Hope Road, he would come, and I would ask him questions. And he would explain a lot. He would explain a lot of weird things, you know, like, we talk about Marcus Garvey, and, you know, them say Marcus Garvey say, there's going to be a black star liner to take, you know,
his black dream of the black shipping line.
Yeah, but check it out. Check out what this elder told me. He was like, you have airliner, and then you have star liner. A star liner isn't a ship.
Oh, the real.
A star liner is a...
In the space, spaceship.
So, you know, we have a lot of eccentric elders who kind of, you know, expose me to all different type of ideas. Like that, like, Marcus Garvey wasn't talking about a ship that on the ocean.
Right.
He was talking about a star liner, which is a whole different thing, which none of us had thought about before. You know, the black star liner. That means it's traveling where the stars travel, right, basically.
He was almost using Marcus Garvey's thing as an inspiration for even further.
Yeah, it's like, so, you know, we learn a lot from the elders, you know? And again, I don't remember. I know the names, but I don't remember them right now. Sure. I tell you the truth, yeah.
No, I understand.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it was a lot of people in the community that influenced you.
Yeah, man. And then even for my own purpose, because, again, I was I'm an independent-minded person from when I was a boy. And as a teenager, you know, I wanted to know myself. I wouldn't accept just what anybody told me, what my father told me or what the elders told me or anything. I wanted to feel something for myself, you know. So I read a lot of books, the Bible being one of them. Just studied a lot of, you know, philosophies, you know, Buddhism, Islam. I just studied a lot of spiritual concepts and philosophies. I visited in this area called Bull Bay. There is another community of Rastafarians who is like, I would call them like the Hasidic Jews of our culture, because they're like a stricter version of
Rastafarians.
Yeah, it's like we call it the Bubba. They were the Bubba Dread at the time, and they lived up in the hills. We used to live down here, and we could see their commune up in the hills there. So I had to visit, as a young youth who was growing up, who wanted to be more in the culture, it was like a rite of passage to visit the community and try and speak to some of the elders there. So they had an elder that they revered, who them call Emmanuel, Prince Emmanuel. And so I went up there looking for Prince Emmanuel, but I couldn't, you know, whatever reason. Some people said he never existed, but anyway, whatever, I couldn't see him or whatever. But we had a lot of discussions with them, because they were so strict. They didn't like reggae music. They were very just drumming. They thought that playing reggae music with electric instrument was like Babylonian and all these type of things. And they didn't like my father a lot either, because he traveled the world and played this electric music.
Like a troubadour almost.
Yeah, so, you know, we had a lot of back and forth with them, you know, trying to understand their concept, and we trying to explain to them, you know, it's necessary for travel and play music. Is we can't stay just in one area and just, you know, we need
to expand.
Communicate with the world, right. You know, experience the world.
It is a way to communicate, yeah, though, too.
We have to communicate with the rest of the world. We can't just communicate with ourselves, you know. So there, it was a lot of back and forth. And there's a lot of segregation even within the culture at that time. Because I remember this vividly, as my father tried to bring the different... The different elements of the Rastafarian culture together, because there's a few of them, 12 tribe, the Bobo, the Naya being God. There's a few different elements of the Rastafarian culture that had their own kind of idea or what things should be. And there was an effort by my father to unify all of the, we call it houses, all of the houses.
Right, and bring them together under one roof.
Yeah, but wasn't successful because there was so much, there's a lot of ego and a lot of self-righteousness, you know, and it just couldn't happen, you know.
So, the Bobos, you respected them.
I respect everyone, you know, yeah, man.
But as a youngster, when you say, you talk about this rite of passage, it was something you looked forward to, or was it necessary? Yeah,
something that I had to do.
You had to do it.
I had to do it to satisfy myself, to satisfy my own searching. It's something that I had to go through.
Did you have the dreads yet?
No, maybe just started. When I was younger, I was dreadlocks from my father. We used to, because our community was, all the youths and were dreadlocks. Right. So I was dread, and then they had to cut me here because of going into the public schools in Jamaica, they didn't allow Rasta. Right.
Exactly.
Children.
It was so like an outcast thing.
Yeah, so they had to cut my hair to put me into school. But then after high school, at the end of high school, I started growing back my locks and started, you know, that search, you know.
When, just stepping back just one moment, when you talked about Bob being away during the struggle, Bob was away, was he in Wilmington?
Yeah.
When you mentioned you actually went there, and he was living with your grandmom then.
Yeah.
You went to school. Explain how you went to go live in Wilmington.
Well, what I understand was my father went, you know, at that time, he was doing welding. My mother was a nurse. And there was not a lot of income in the house. We were living in Trenchtown at the time. So he went away to try and, you know, see if him can
get an income, basically.
Yeah, get a better job in America and or whatever. And afterwards, I think, you know, my mother and them just decided, let's bring up the kids, see if we can get a better life. There, his mother was there, so there's family there, and maybe we could have a better life there. So that's when we went up to Delaware, and they put us in the elementary school there. We never stay long, though. It was like a couple of years, and the cold and the snow, and so I don't think my family was very happy being in there. We came right back home, so
I can relate.
Yeah,
no question. But it was, why Delaware? I mean, why Wilmington?
That's where his mother went. That's where his mother was.
What? Sedalia Booker.
Yeah, and I think she had family that was there before her.
So that's what drove her.
So
there.
Yeah, it's like that's how it usually happens in Jamaica. It's like somebody went, and then all right, then another family member, they go where the family went before.
Sure.
But I remember being in Delaware, and that's the first time I ever heard of Christmas or anything like that. Then the first time I saw a Christmas tree, and got like toys, and heard about the Santa Claus guy, and. It was very interesting, you know, get some Batman thing and $6 million, and it was...
$6 million man.
Yeah, it's the first time we get exposed to that whole culture. Yeah, right. Yeah.
That's wild. And it was in Wilmington.
Yeah.
And you don't remember the elementary school. Was it Highlands?
No.
But it was there in Wilmington.
Yeah, man. I don't remember anything.
It's left an indelible mark there in the community, because as you may or may not know, they don't have a whole lot of musical heritage or background. There's one somewhat well-known rock artist, George Thorogood, who is from Delaware. And aside from him, they've really latched on to every year there's a Bob Marley festival summer. And you mentioned a lot of your relatives. And can you just expound on who is there and what are they doing?
My cousins are there, my grand aunts, you know, and all the offsprings. But all of my relatives in Delaware, another experience we had in Delaware was the exposure to Christianity, church. Because my grandmother, her sister, my uncles, all of her family was church-going Christian people. So we used to go to church a lot. You know, it's the Pentecostal kind of churches where he's, you know, speaking tongues and singing and, you know, all of this turkey and whatever.
They speaking in tongues.
Yeah, all type of things. So we used to go to, you know, grandma used to let us go to church a lot. So we got exposed to that. And up to this day, most of my family, they're priests, they're pastors, they're church.
They own are churches. Practicing.
Yeah, they all have churches. My grand aunt, she has her church. So it's all spiritual people.
And are you still close with them?
Yeah, man. We talk to my grand auntie every now and again, you know.
And she lives in Wilmington?
Yeah, she lives in Wilmington.
And you visit there frequently?
Not
once a year.
Frequently, yeah.
At least once a year.
Yeah.
Is the religion, that's another area of you that I think is, when you talk about religion with Ziggy, and you feel this, you know, your reaction is, and it's a great one, you talk about, it's love. Love is my religion. And I've heard you say it a few times. When you think about your family, who are obviously deeply into the Christianity that they're into, enough so that they're sharing it with others, their preachers, their pastors, is there any kind of disconnect between where you're thinking, or how do you guys relate on that spiritual area?
Well, how I feel about it is everybody have their own role. You know, it's like to get to this building, you have a couple different routes you can take. But you all come in here, you know what I'm saying? So that's how I think about it. It's not either or, it's not one way, it's not, you know, if you don't go my way, then you're going the wrong way. You go whichever way you go. But all of my family is loving people, and that is what matters at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Open-minded people, loving people, helpful people, charitable people. And it is that those are the traits that you look for in truly spiritual people. No matter what denomination you're coming from, there are certain traits that you must have.
And that are all shared.
Yeah.
And
that
break down the barriers.
Yeah,
and the walls.
It's like, you know what, you know, so the problem I have with what, you know, the existing religions do in terms of their function from the top. That mean I'm not talking about my family church. There are people who are loving and things. I'm talking about the head of these organizations.
The organization itself.
Yeah, the head. The
bureaucracy, the administration.
Yeah. It's a division that it caused between the human family. Now my family, in terms of me or my grand aunt or any of my family within their own churches or practices, they would never turn anybody away or condemn anybody.
They're accepting.
Yeah, that's not the spirit.
Right.
You know, but within the bureaucracy of it is if you're not a Christian, if you're not baptized, you don't say Jesus, you don't have a chance. If you don't say Allah, you don't have a chance.
And you don't like that.
No, that is not true.
Exactly.
Because it's not true. It's not true.
It's like breaking the bond of humanity.
Yeah, it's not true. It's not true. You know, sometimes I would go as far as saying, you know, the message that I have, which is love is my religion, is coming from the source of, from the source. This is the ultimate, as far as we as human beings can express and understand this kind of, what we are imagining or what we have made up or what we're searching for. The best description or the best way.
Summary?
Yeah, the best way I believe that I can explain it, or I can say this, the end of the road is love. It must be love. It's the culmination, is the end product. If the end product is not loving everybody and everybody's love, then
there's something wrong with
it. Something wrong with it. You know? And within the establishment of religion, they're not saying that. They're saying, if you don't come and say what I say.
Right. Yeah, and we're right, the others are wrong.
Yeah, no, it's not. That is not right.
And it instills division. It can't possibly be right.
That is not right.
How could so many people all have a different vision
of what it
is? How did you fall in love with your wife?
I never fall in love with my wife. I just love her. I don't fall in love. You know,
how did you know that was going to be?
Oh, well, You know, we look at that point in stage in my life, I had many experiences in terms of, you know, women and love and all of these type of things. But when you find love that is unconditional, then that is a true love, which is the same love we're speaking about. The God love.
Right.
The Jah love, the Allah love, the Yahweh love is unconditional. You don't care where you come from, what you're saying, who you are.
Or who your background is.
Yeah, you don't care. Right. That the love of the Almighty don't care about.
It's universal.
Your denomination.
Right.
Him love everyone.
Yeah, it's above all of that.
You know, so this is a love. This is a true love. And when we found that love, that is how we accepted it, you know, and just we went with it, you know.
Was her religion ever a factor, or had she already sort of evolved into the way that you thought prior to?
No, I mean, we never thought, well, we never even known about religion. We never.
So it's not a big deal to her?
In the beginning, there was nothing about religion or not like that. I mean, actually, yeah, she did. There was something she did say to me once.
I thought there had to be something.
Because she didn't think it could work, you know? And I said to her, yeah, man, you know what I mean? It doesn't matter, you know? It can't, everything, it doesn't matter. She never thinks, these two, you know, sides of the thing could come together.
Right. You from Trenchtown.
Yeah, you know.
And she was from Tel Aviv.
Israel, yeah. So she never, and you know, it's very difficult within that culture because the family is such a strong thing in their culture where they're very, very involved in the life of, you know, the marriage
family,
and
right.
What's happening and who you're marrying and all of these type of things. So, you know, before we even got serious, she said, oh, she don't think something like this could work, you know? But we know love, you can't fight love, you know? If you fight love, you lose, you know?
That's just an amazing thing, the way you've, the connections between, like you described it, you coming from there, she coming from where she was, and the whole evolution that really made you, the perspective
well,
that
it
you
was,
have.
It was to be because in every aspect of life, there's lessons that will be learned, and there's people who need to learn lessons. Our coming together teach the surrounding, who surrounds us, a lesson of it doesn't matter.
Right. It does. It's a great lesson. It's a huge show of unity.
Her parents, there's a whole ring, and it gets wider and wider.
Right.
And you know what I mean? It's a whole circle, whatever them say, circle of life. You know what I mean? It's like, there's something in this little small sense, but then it affects.
It's like a microcosm.
Yeah, and then it affects, and then it affects, yeah. And then it affects. So it's definitely something that I feel was meant to be, and for bigger reasons than just my personal love of her or her love of mine. You know, there's much more bigger things happening that we have no idea of why it's happening.
Right.
You know, but
driving forces.
Yeah, man, it happened.
When you talk about lessons, when did you first learn to play the guitar?
Learn to play the guitar. We started practicing playing the drums, you know, with my father, rehearsals. You know, when they used to rehearse, you know, Hope Road, them take break, you know, jump on the drum. Me and my brother Steve, boom, boom, bam, boom, boom, boom. You know, daddy come, hey, don't play around, it's not a play around, don't play around with that thing, it's not a toy or whatever. All right, you know, then after my father passed, you know, I'm kind of getting on the guitar. I started writing some songs, you know, just before he passed. I started kind of writing some little songs about some little girls and stuff like that. Never started really playing the guitar yet, though. And then after him passed, I got interested in the guitar. My mother got me some lessons with some an individual there. But I didn't stay in that too long. I don't know. I'm not good at being in classes. I'm not good at that. My excuse is that my mind is too free.
It's a good excuse.
Yeah. My mind is too free. I can't be like, you know, structured. I don't like it.
Right.
So after a couple weeks of that never worked out. Then I started teaching myself, buying books, looking at guitar cards and then, you know, teaching myself stuff. It was good, though, to do the classes because it started the process.
A foundation.
Yes.
Right.
So it's always good. It's just like, you know, going to church. And even me going to a Catholic school, it was good for me because it started the wheels turning in my head.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, we don't denounce anything. Everything is for a purpose. But what we must understand, and I go back to this religion thing for a second, is that being within a denomination or being within any idea is not the end. There's no end, actually. There's no end to the knowledge and wisdom that we can learn. If the concept of the universe and of God, if people say God is infinite, then the concept of this philosophy cannot be held in any one book or in any one human idea of what it is.
It's not defined, it's growing almost.
Yes, so that's another problem I have with the establishment of religion, where people within their different philosophies think that's it. You know, I'm a Catholic and this is what the Catholic teach, that's it. I'm Islam, that's it. That's why I say I have a free mind, and this is what we are born with. We must continue using our free mind to evolve the philosophies of our life, of humanity, and not just think it's ended with what this guy said and what that guy said. We, each individual, have the power to evolve them own self. And that's what I do. That's why I come up with Love is My Religion. But that was my own wheels turning into continuing the evolution, not stopping with what my father teach me, not stopping with what my mother teach me, or right. The elders, but continuing my journey to the truth. It continues. So
it's a work in progress.
Yeah, always. You, it's never that's what I don't like. It's not, don't believe that because you're in something and they're saying this, that means it's the end all of what it should be. The end all, there's no end all, actually. It must continue with you, your own freedom of thought and wisdom. Because there's inner wisdom that we must learn for ourselves that nobody can tell us. You know, there's certain things that we have to learn with self, you know?
And I guess just as a final note, because you've been very generous, you've given me a lot of time today. I really appreciate it. When you think about the future and Marley has, over several decades, become almost a brand, there are so many siblings who are involved in music. Your father's legacy hangs over all of you almost. Is there a goal or a mission that you have, like a long-term vision that you want to end up with in terms of like who you are or how you see your family as like contributors in this realm of social consciousness, I guess it would be. It's like you don't waste your time. You know, you sing things that have meaning. You know, you have a lot of meaning in your life and you're surrounded by it in your entire family.
Yeah, well, you know, I have this dilemma at times because I know I have a purpose, you know, and each of us, as quote unquote Marleys, is individuals who must, for themselves, figure out what they're. It's not like you're a Marley, every Marley have this. This is, we're all individuals.
That's right.
So I speak as an individual. Mm-hmm. I have dilemmas because, I have had, disappointment in terms of when I was younger, I thought I needed to see, you know, what I was doing. I needed to see the world change because, you know, but it was unrealistic and naive of me. I didn't know.
Idealistic.
Yeah. You know, I didn't know. But as I grow and I learn, I understand that what we do, we just have to do what we do. We can't expect anything. We can't put any higher value on it. You know, we just have to do it. So one of my, what's one of my thing that I'm feeling, and I've been feeling this for a long time, and I've been feeling I'm kind of lazy with it at times, and I'm not doing enough to fulfill what I feel one of my main purpose is. And it is to be a part of or to help to reignite the flames of African unity. It's been, it's like one of...
it's one of your father's themes.
Yeah, it's like, it's my father's theme, you know, Nkrumah, a lot of our, Afrocentric ideas there. But that is something that I feel is one of my main purposes here. To be a, be some, small, big, whatever part I can
a
play.
A unifier?
Eh?
A unifier?
Yeah, African, I want, there's something I need to do in Africa, you know what I'm saying?
There's a calling you have,
yeah.
And you haven't quite figured it out entirely, but you have a strong calling relating to
it's
Africa.
Something, it's like, you know, it's pulling at my heart.
I like it.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. It's pulling at me.
It's inspiring you, and you're just not quite sure what it will end up being.
Yeah, but sometimes I feel as if I'm not doing enough, you know, so now I'm trying to pick up the pace. I'm trying to like, come on, you have to get going with this thing, if, you know?
Because life is short.
Yeah, you need to get going with whatever it is you need to do, you know? You know, sometimes family life, everything gets you kind of...
complacent?
Know? Yeah, complacent and comfortable. And I understand why some of, even my father, I understand why my father was the way he was. Because if you get too caught in, it's a good thing, but if you get too... caught up in a family life.
You forget about that.
You miss.
Right.
Yes, I'm sorry, but it's, you know, it's, some of us have things to do that sometimes you have to put aside family life a little bit and it hurts, but you have to do it because it's something is, you know, cause I understand why my father and many, most of the great people of our time, of our history, had to do that, you know, had to sacrifice.
If they're a visionary.
Yeah, you have to sacrifice something to achieve that, you know. So, you know, I've just been trying to create a good balance. But I think that besides from just being inspired to sing good music and create messages and sing the truth and stuff like that, the concept of African unity, I don't see anyone else... Personally, I don't see anyone else having, doing, or feeling that. I don't know. Maybe there's someone else that feels the same way I do.
But you don't hear anyone pushing it the way your dad was doing.
I don't hear anybody pushing it. And it's something that I know it's inevitable. I know it has to happen.
And it's so needed, isn't it?
Yeah, it has to happen. It's, everybody, you know, Africa is a big deal for me, and there's so much problems there, and everybody looking for a solution. You know, every now and again, there's a band-aid or a song.
Right.
Africa, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
That's not the solution. Gotta be a lot more than that. Yeah, I know. I know what you mean.
The solution is unifying Africa.
Right. And you can't symbolize it with a song. Or
yeah, it's not a charity concert thing. It's an African thing, really. And that's why we are looking forward to going to Africa, speaking to the students in Africa, you know, just focusing more on Africa with that message of African unity. And that is one of my biggest missions that I know I have it, but I've given myself that responsibility to try and do as much as I can to help that along, you know.
To make it happen.
Yeah, whether I make it happen or be a, you know, just...
But at least to try.
Just help to... get the fire started, you know, get it in the ear of the people, in the minds of the people again, because no one is, the African governments or whatever, no one is talking about it. No one is talking about it. And I think, I don't see anything more important than that in terms of Africa, because I think Africa is the future of the world. As it was in the beginning, it shall be in the end. It's Africa established the world.
It did. So, education, yeah, science, you know? Everything in thousands of years ago.
So we believe that it's going to come around again full circle, but the unity of Africa is something that we believe is a must, you know?
Well, that's a great goal to have, and certainly something that I'm sure your father would admire.
Yeah. See, you know, it's a big deal, you know, it's a big deal. So.
Well, you've got a big heart, And I've admired that so much about you, the way you care about children, the way you respect the past, the way you embrace so many different cultures. You do it in your music with songs like Shalom, Salam. You know, you do it on stage, and it's been a pleasure getting to hear some of these details about your family. And certainly that's a nice way to leave it, thinking about that you have this driving, gnawing kind of thing inside that will not let you go, that it's calling you, and it's still yet undefined precisely what the mission will be.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
I can tell. I'm picking up on it. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Is there any possible way I can talk a song out of you while I've got all this stuff set up?
It's hard for not, you know, say a guitar or not. You're very smart. Love play Love Is My Religion. It's my favorite song, really. So I'll just play that one again. Condemn, I don't convert. This is a calling, have you heard? Bring all the lovers to the fold. No one is gonna lose their soul. 'Cause all my days I've been searching out what this life is worth. Through the books I've looked, through time I've searched. It's love. Love is my religion. Love is my religion. Hey, let's go fly a kite, you know. There's nothing we can cure. Said I keep you in my arms for sure. Oh, so don't let nobody stop us. Spirits have to soar. With you I share this gift, this gift that we now know. Searching now, I found out what this life is worth, yeah. Not in the book did I find, 'cause I've been searching inside, yeah. You see, I don't condemn, I don't convert. Calling, have you heard? Have you heard? us to the fold. I let you know, no one is gonna lose their soul. 'Cause it's love, love.
Thank you.
Yeah, man, nice.
I really appreciate that.
Yeah, yeah.
That was very nice. And thank you. It's Y Public Radio, Ziggy Marley. Thank you, Ziggy.
Mahalo, brother. Yeah, man, respect, respect.